And the first topic we're going to talk about is this major Hess compatibility complex and the TCR. And let me just sort of give you again a historical background for this. The major histocompatibility complex was first identified as being a set of genes, a group of genes that were involved in tissue rejection or transplantation. When you try transplanting tissues between either different people or in the case of laboratory animals between different mice strains, the tissues were rejected. And when they mapped where those genes that encoded that ability to reject the tissues, where they mapped, it turns out they mapped in this area that became referred to as the MHC or major histocompatibility complex. Now, we're not going to talk today about the role of MHC in transplantation. Dr. Prakash Nagarkarni is going to come back, and he's going to talk. It is Prakash that does transplantation, or is it Mitzi? Mitzi's going to come back and talk about the role of MHC in transplantation. I'm going to deal with the role of MHC in the immune system. That's how these genes were actually first identified. It was also noticed that these were highly, highly polymorphic genes. In other words, if you looked in the human population, there were hundreds of different alleles of these genes. So it's very, very polymorphic set of genes. Now, the initial breakthrough studies actually came from studies with inbred strains of mice. Studies with inbred strains of mice show that these same genes in the same locus were also involved in immune responses. And the reason I say that is that, remember we said that there can be responders and non-responders. What was done was to use these some strains of mice that would respond to a particular antigen, others that would not. And they mapped to find out where does this response, what controls this response. And it turns out that those genes mapped to this MHC region as well. So the MHC genes were somehow involved in immune responses as well. Now, it turns out as these molecules were identified, that were encoded by this locus, and again, we're talking about a locus that contains a lot of different genes in this particular area of the chromosome. They fall into three classes. They're the class 1 genes and the class 2 genes. These classes are really based on the structure of these particular genes, and we'll talk a lot about what the structure of these class 1 and class 2 genes are. And the third class is class 3 genes, and class 3 is actually sort of everything else. It's either, if a thing has a certain structure, it's a class 1 gene. If it has another structure, it's a class 2 gene. If it's not, neither class 1 or class 3 was thrown into class 3. There's no particular structure. It's just everything else that's not class 1 or class 2. We'll be primarily talking about the class 1 and the class 2 genes, although I'll have a few comments to make about the class 3 gene. Now, the class 1 MHC molecules are found on all nucleated cells. This is in humans that we're talking about. All of our nucleated cells. So the only cells that don't have this is in red blood cells. Now, in other species, actually, red blood cells can have these, express these antigens as well. But in humans, it's only found on the nucleated cells. In contrast, the class 2 MHC are only found on a subpopulation of cells that can act as the antigen-presenting cells. So that includes your dendritic cells, macrophages, B cells, and a few other cells like the thymic epithelial cells. So you have sort of a situation like this. All of our nucleated cells express class 1. A subset of these cells express class 2, and the red blood cells are sort of out of here. Now, notice that means that these cells, APCs, we're going to always talk about APCs as cells that bear class 2. But keep in mind, they also have class 1. Right, because they're part of they're within this bigger circle. So they are a nucleated cell. They also express class 1, but they function as APCs because they express class 2. Now, the class 3 MHC molecules It can be a variety of different molecules. Some of the genes in that locus code for molecules that have absolutely nothing to do with the immune response. Others have things to do with immune responses in some ways. For example, some of the complement components are actually are class 3 antigens encoded in the MHC. There are also a group of proteins that are referred to as transporter proteins. When we talk about how APCs process and present antigens to the T cells, we're going to see what the role of these transporter proteins are. So some of the class 3 proteins actually participate in immune responses in some ways, but they don't have the structure of class 1 or class 2 antigens. Now, it wasn't until the nature of the TCR was established and how a TCR interacts with antigen that until we understood that, we really could not understand what the role of the MHC was in the immune responses. And what we know now is that the TCR recognizes peptides, antigenic peptides, in association with the MHC molecules. In some cases, it's an association with a class 1 molecule. In some cases, it's an association with a class 2 molecule. Okay? So in the case of the cytotoxic cells, they recognize antigen bound to class 1 MHC molecules. And T helper cells recognize antigen in association with class 2 MHC molecules. But these molecules, the antigens that the T cells recognize are always peptides. And that's why proteins are T-dependent antigens and polysaccharides are T-independent, because T cells don't recognize polysaccharides. Okay, and of course, we know now the actual three-dimensional structure of not only the class 1 and class 2 MHC molecules, but also the TCR and how these things interact. So we have a pretty good picture of how the TCR recognizes these antigens. And so let's talk about the antigens, and we'll start off with the MHC class 1 antigens. They exist as two polypeptide chains. There's a long chain that is referred to as the alpha chain, and then there's a small beta chain. In the case of the class 1 MHC molecules, that beta chain is always beta 2 microglobulin. Now, beta 2 microglobulin, that gene for beta 2 microglobulin is actually not even in the MHC. It's encoded somewhere else in the genome, but it associates with the alpha chain. It's the alpha chain that is encoded for by a gene in the MHC. And now if you look at that alpha chain, there are four basic regions. There's a part in the cytoplasm that contains all sorts of phosphorylation sites and places for signal transduction and association with cytoskeletal proteins. So you have a piece of the protein actually in the cytoplasm. Then there's the transmembrane piece with a lot of hydrophobic amino acids to allow insertion into the membrane. And then outside the cell, there are three domains. And again, these domains are very similar to the domains that we talked about in the case of the immunoglobulin. In fact, it's thought that these genes actually were derived from the same primordial gene as the immunoglobulins. So you have these globular regions, each of which contain an intrachain disulfide bond forming a globular type domain. And so you have three of them. The alpha 3 domain here is highly conserved. So remember we said that there's a lot of polymorphisms, there's a lot of different alleles for these genes out in the population. But the alpha 3 region is actually fairly conserved. Again, it doesn't mean that everything is identical, but it's highly conserved. And then the other two domains, the alpha 2 domain and the alpha 1 domain, are highly polymorphic. So this is where the polymorphisms are found, in the alpha 1 and the alpha 2 domain. And it's these domains that create the site that the peptide is going to bind. Right? The beta 2 microglobulin does not contribute to the peptide binding capacity of the class 1 molecules. The peptide binding, again, is determined by alpha 1 and alpha 2. But beta 2 microglobulin is important for a couple of reasons. Number one, A class 1 molecule won't have the appropriate conformation in order to bind peptide. But also, without beta 2 microglobulin, this molecule will never even be make it to the membrane. So to get expression of the class 1 molecules on the membrane requires beta 2 microglobulin. And there are deficiencies, people that have deficiencies in the gene for beta 2 microglobulin, and these individuals phenotypically do not have class 1 MHC molecules on their cells, all right, because they can't get it to the surface. They make it, but it stays inside the cell. It can't go out to the surface because it's not folded properly. And so beta 2 microglobulin, while it doesn't contribute to the peptide binding groove, it does play an important role in keeping getting the thing onto the surface of the cell and in keeping the appropriate conformation. Here's one of those variability plots that I showed you, similar with the immunoglobulin. We're looking at the variability as a function of amino acid residue. And you can see that most of the variability in this molecule occurs in the alpha-1 and the alpha-2 domain. Alpha-3 domain is much more constant. Again, it doesn't mean that they're identical. But if you look in the population, most of the variability in the heterogeneity in this group of molecules localize in alpha-1 and alpha-2. And in fact, when you look at the structure from the X-ray crystallography and you construct these models as to how the molecule looks, if you look at the peptide binding groove, it's composed of this. You have these two alpha helices, and then at the bottom you have a beta-pleated sheet conformation that acts as a floor. And in this little pocket is where the peptide is going to bind. Okay? Now, these areas indicated here in red, these are the areas that are very highly polymorphic. So when you look at where the polymorphism lies, it lies on those amino acids that basically line this groove or sit at the bottom of this peptide binding groove. So that's where the polymorphisms go. And those are the amino acids that make contact with the peptide. So it depends on which amino acids are present in these areas will dictate then which polypeptide is going to bind into that binding groove. Now, this groove is large enough to accommodate approximately 8 to 10 amino acids in length. And that's why, if you remember back when I talked about the size of the epitopes recognized by T cells, I said it's roughly about 8 to 10 amino acids. This is the size that this groove actually will accommodate. Now, there are some T cells can actually recognize slightly larger things. We'll talk about that in a second. But in the class 1 molecules, it's about 8 to 10 amino acids long, the peptide that will fit into this groove, and that's what the T cell recognizes. Now, there are some rules that govern which peptide will bind into that groove. And so, for example, for one of the class 1 MHC molecules, the rules are the following. In order for a peptide to bind to a particular MHC molecule, it has to have a leucine at the carboxy terminal end of the peptide, and it has to have a tyrosine. F is phenylalanine, Margaret? All right, so it either has to have a tyrosine or a phenylalanine in the third position from the C-terminal end, okay? Or the fourth position, okay? So if those rules are obeyed, then the peptide will bind to this group. Those are referred to as the anchor sites. So there are certain anchor site rules. Now, what that means, of course, is that this groove, then, in this particular class 1 MHC molecule, can really bind a number of peptides, provided it's got a leucine here, a tyrosine, or a phenylalanine there. Okay? The rest of the sequence is irrelevant. So that means that each class 1 molecule can actually bind a lot of different peptides, as long as the anchor sites are correct. Here's a different Class 1 MHC. Okay, this one's got slightly different rules. It's got to have a valine on isoleucine or leucine at the carboxy terminal end, and it's got to have a tyrosine, one amino acid from the amino terminal end. Again, it doesn't make any difference what the sequence is in here. As long as those anchor sites are correct, it will bind to that group. And so again, that molecule will bind multiple different peptides. And so each of our class 1 MHC molecules actually bind many different peptides. They just have to obey certain anchor site rules. Now, this has some implications, and there's a lot of interest in trying to determine what these anchor site rules are, because if we understand what the anchor sites, what these rules are, then we should be able to design peptides to be used as vaccines. I mean, what if you knew this rule, for example, you could create a peptide that is valine or isoleucine here, tyrosine here, and then put in some sequence here that's found in some pathogen. And then you just use this peptide to immunize with. And it's very easy to say, I mean, these peptides are only 8 to 10 amino acids long. It's very easy to synthesize small peptides like that. So there's a lot of interest in trying to establish what are these anchor site rules that apply to each molecule. And each class 1 molecule is going to have its own set of rules for its anchor sites. So there's a lot of work going on in that area, and people are trying to develop these vaccines based on those rules. Now, this shows you some of the degree of polymorphism. Now, in the case of humans, the MHC, the major histocompatibility complex, is also referred to as the HLA locus. So there are three class 1 genes in this MHC, the HLA locus. HLA-A, HLA-B, and HLA-C. And this goes to show you the degree of polymorphism. So in the population, in the human population, there are about 218 different alleles of this gene alone. 400 of the HLA-B. Now, there are actually some more class 1 antigens encoded in the MHC besides HLA-A, B, and C. There's an E, F, and G, but there's not a lot of polymorphisms in there. We're not going to discuss those any further. These are the ones that are most highly polymorphic. These are the ones that contribute most to immune responses, and it also determines these are the ones that are most important in transplantation when you get to the transplantation lecture. So keep in mind that there are other class 1 genes encoded in the MHC besides HLA-A, B, and C, but these are the ones that are important. Okay, so it just shows you the degree of polymorphism in the population. All right, let's take a break here, and then we'll go on to the class 2.